Good morning, Common Ground. Welcome to church this morning. We're so glad to see each and every one of you here at church. Beautiful day outside, wonderful winter weather we're having. If you would, stand to your feet. We're going to sing, "Come, now is the time to worship you." Speaking of God Almighty, stand to your feet and sing with us as we praise God this morning.
Well, good morning and welcome to Common Ground, Spring Valley. I'm Rose Dani Ortiz. I'm your associate pastor here at our church, and I'm just happy and excited to be here with you. A day of remembering Martin Luther King Jr. And as you saw on the video, we begin our worship hearing part of Martin Luther King Jr.'s speech, I Have a Dream. And this week is an opportunity to remember two things: that one person can make a big difference, and that when we are doing things in the name of God for justice, we will not stand alone. Amen? So today we're going to continue to celebrate and honor the work of Martin Luther King Jr. and the legacy he left all of us to fight for justice and equality to all human beings. And in honor, we are invited to watch one of his speeches at the end of our worship service in the sanctuary of our church. So in that same spirit, remembering how we all can continue to live out MLK legacy to fight for justice, we're going to continue to sing praises with our worship band. We're going to continue with our sermon series, Glimpses of the Kingdom. And we also have the opportunity to support our mission of sharing love and shaping lives with our offering. And then we're going to hear all about the things that we all can engage in the life and activities of our church. So as a community of faith, we would love to know that you're worshiping with us this morning, whether in person or online. So those who are here, we want to remind you to fill out your attendance cards. There are some cards on your chairs that you can fill out, and there in the back, there's prayer requests. If you have any prayer that we can pray for you, just leave them there. And if you're watching us online, you can send us a private message and let us know that you're worshiping with us. And if you're here for the very first time, we welcome you. We want to extend a very warm and a special welcome, and we're so glad that you're here with us as our very special guest. So now, let us stand all together and let us pray to our God as we continue to worship this morning. God, you're so loving and compassionate. You hear the audible cries of the poor, the hungry, and the homeless. You also hear the silence of inaction. When we become too comfortable and complacent, disturb our peace with questions. Ask us, how many times have we valued only those who look and sound like ourselves? How often have we laughed at jokes that demean others? How often have we smiled outwardly and judged inwardly? If we love you, if we truly love our neighbor, God, ignore our excuses and lead us to an honest response, because that is the only way we can grow, we can learn, and lead us into action through our faith in you. Bless this worship service and let us be open to experience you. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen, amen. We're also celebrating what we call Epiphany right now. That is the light of the world, that Jesus is with us now. He has brought light and he has brought sunshine to us, to our lives. We're going to sing about that right now, called We Are the Light of the World. A heavy secret, a heavy shame, every fear, every pain. I live inside the dark, but that's not who we are. We are children of the day. So wake up, sleeper, lift your head. We were meant for more than this. Fight the shadows, conquer sin, make the most of the time we have left. We are the light of the world. We are the city on the hill. We are the light of the world. We got it. We are called to spread the news, tell the world the simple truth that Jesus came to save. The freedom in His name, so let His love ride through. Wake up, sleeper, lift your head. We were meant for more than this. Broke the light and conquered death. Make the most of the time we live. We are the light of the world. We are the city on the hill. We gotta shift the light on. We are the light of the world. We are the city on the hill. We are the light of the world. And we gotta let the light shine.
We're so grateful today, God, that you are with us here.
where two or more are gathered in your name, you are in the presence. You are here, Lord, speaking to us, inspiring us, revealing yourself to us. We thank you so much, Jesus, that you are the light of the world. You have shined in the darkness, and you've given us hope. You've given us reason to live. You've given us all the wonderful things, God, that we can never have imagined before. We thank you, dear Lord, that we don't put our trust in men, no matter how powerful they may seem, no matter how powerful they may look. Our trust is only in you, dear Lord. And we thank you for that today. In all these things we pray, amen. You may be seated.
Well, good morning, Common Ground. It's so great to have you all here to continue to worship our Lord this morning. And as we mentioned in the beginning, we continue with our sermon series, Glimpses of the Kingdom. And this sermon series is designed to help us see the kingdom of God live out in concrete ways within the body of Christ. And last week, we talk about our covenant with God through one of the means of grace, baptism. And we heard the story of Jesus' baptism, and we were encouraged to live out the example of Jesus Christ by rejecting sin, by forgiving, committing ourselves to live out that example, to be part of God's kingdom, and to nurture one another. So this morning, let us go into our scripture that is found on 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. And let us see together how, you know, Paul begins his letter to the 1 Corinthians, to the church of Corinthians. So let us read 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 to 9. And it says the following. Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes, to the church of God, this is in Corinth, to those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints, together with all of those who in every place call on the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, both their Lord and ours. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I give thanks to my God always for you because of the grace of God that has been given in you with Christ. For in every way you have been enriched in him, in speech and knowledge of every kind, just as the testimony of Christ has been strengthened among you, so that you are not lacking on any spiritual gift as you wait for the revealing of our Lord Jesus Christ. He will also strengthen you to the end, so that you may be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful. By him you were called into the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. God, we thank you for allowing us to come together this morning, for removing all obstacles or distractions to be in here at this space, to hear your word, to worship your name. We come, God, asking you to leave all of our worries away, to give them to you in prayer. And help us be open to receive the message that you have for us today. Speak to us, God. Speak to us this morning in a very special way. May the words that come out from my mouth are coming from you. All of this we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Do you remember the way you learned how to drive your car? You remember those days? Were fun, right? Well, I remember having, you know, my first time, like, having, like, my learning's license, right, that I had, you know, after passing a written test in Puerto Rico. And after you have that license, you got your picture and everything, so, you know, you get excited because it looks like an official license, but it's not. So you feel like a big girl. And, you know, a couple of months, you know, you start driving and learning how to drive before you take the official driving test. So, well, I remember that my dad, you know, took me to these parking spaces on the weekends that were empty to make sure, you know, I didn't do anything bad as I was, like, learning to drive. And, you know, as I learned a little bit that he trusted in me, he let me drive to the swimming practice, of course, with him. He let me drive to the supermarket. He let me drive to the bakery. And in Puerto Rico, there are a lot of bakeries. So it's like, it was fun to me. So, like, you know, he let me practice all with him, never alone. And when the driver test was approaching, my parents then preferred to spend, you know, some extra money to hire someone to teach me more things. And, you know, like how to park, taking the driving test route before taking the test. And, you know, they calculated that it was better to, you know, spend a little bit more money to make sure that I had, you know, everything covered, that I learned everything that I needed to learn. And, you know, in case they missed something and they forgot to teach me and I didn't pass my test. So I had, you know, all the things, making sure that I had all the things that I needed to keep me myself safer when I started driving officially. So my parents, you know, tried their best to provide everything that they think of that I needed to prepare for that driving test. And there are many situations in life that we may say to ourselves, if only I knew more. How we say that? A lot of time, right? Or if I had more of this, I would have perhaps done this. Or if I were more like this person, I would have done this, right? We have kind of like have that thinking. My parents had that thinking, like saying, you know, if I had the driving classes that you had when I was a child, I would have passed for the first time, right? That was their saying. So they were like trying to make sure that I didn't have the struggle that they went through. And if we move these thoughts into our faith, perhaps we may have said to ourselves, if I was like this teacher that I grew up, or like this mentor, or like Apostle Paul, or any hero of the faith that you may think of, then I will do great things for God. Have you thought about that too? And this week, we're celebrating Martin Luther King Jr. And maybe we could have asked ourselves, what kind of church or nation will we be if we all learn from his example of faith and life? Perhaps some of us, the way we respond to life has been, you know, that there's so much to learn, right? That there's life brings us opportunity to continue learning, a nonstop learning, because it is a process. Life is a process. And I confess, at times, I can sound like this. I can sound like this. Perhaps I sometimes feel the lack of accomplishments just because of something that I'm still missing, something that I need to learn, something that I'm still lacking, knowledge, some skill, some resources. So Paul was writing to the church of Corinth about the opposite attitude. Not a lack of confidence at all. Too much confidence. And this group of Christians thought of themselves as better as the rest of the believers. That's how they thought of themselves. And all because they had the ability of speaking in tongues. They thought that because they were able to do this, they were more favored, they were more equipped, or even more special than the rest of the Christians. To the point that they were like closed doors. You know, they were not listening to someone else but themselves. Because they felt like the last Coca-Cola of the world. The best. So this is why Paul begins sharing his credentials. You know, saying, hey, I'm apostle. I'm apostle of Christ. In other words, saying, hey, I know that you're too confident to hear someone else, but I'm here. And I hope you listen to me for your sake, because I am apostle, which means someone who is sent. Not only that, but Paul reminds them of their call, which is one that is shared by all Christians, all believers in Christ, called to be saints. And which meant someone that recognized this Savior, someone that has said yes to Jesus, someone that belongs to God through Jesus Christ. That is saint. So in other words, Paul was reminding them that they belong to God, which meant something larger than themselves. This reminds me of King's legacy to the church, that we are all called to live out not by our own wisdom, not by our own preference or prejudices, but by the call of God into a vision of the kingdom that brings hope. Not only that, but they were all in this together. But the problem with the Church of Corinth is that they proclaim themselves as the superheroes of faith. As the super Christians. I could imagine them at that time. Because, you know, I have this, and I this, and I'm the best. That's how they felt. And they totally forgot about the big picture. They totally forgot. So what Paul does here, in the very beginning of his letter, well, he reminds them, once again, that we are all called, which means that God invites us all to be part of God's people, to be set apart for God, and because of this call, we are all. Not just Corinth, all. All are enriched in speech, all are enriched in knowledge, and spiritual gifts. So Paul is not saying we will be enriched, or that we could be enriched, or that we may might be enriched. No, 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 no. He's saying we all have been, all believers. So he goes even deeper, more deeper, saying that we believers, not just Corinth, are not lacking any spiritual gift, not lacking on any. So in other words, what Paul is saying is that we have everything that we need to be the church of God has called us to be. We have everything. We have everything. So let us say, you know, let us say the truth here. We spend time witching a lot. And I confess, I'm one of those too. I wish a lot. We spend time wishing. I wish we had more people here at church. I wish we spent time with more resources. Or wishing that we, you know, or if I have this, thinking I wish if I have this and this amount of money and this amount of people and this and this and this, our church will be this. And our church would do this and that, right? We wish. We spend time wishing we had some more volunteers for our mobile pantry. We wish we had more volunteers for our Astrid Street Day that it was today morning. We wish to have more activities in our church. And we wish that more people in our community respond to our invitation to come to church. We wish so many wishes, right? But Paul is saying, hey, you have everything. You have everything. What you need to be a church. You have everything. You're not lacking anything. So be thankful. Be thankful for what you have. Be thankful for the people, those who give so much of themselves serving God through the church, the resources that you have. The missions, the witness. And I understand we want more, right? We want more people, we want more resources, we want more activities, we want more and more and more. But have you thought that perhaps our desire to have more can be not because we may feel that there's something lacking in our church? But what if we think of that we want more because we don't want anyone else to miss out the joy of God? What if we think of we want more because we want them to experience the love of God, God's grace, what we are experiencing at this very moment? What if we want more because we want others to enjoy that? And as United Methodist Church, in the last years, we have been a very big transition time, right? Others may say a time of reformation. And as Bishop Karen said in a social media post, the gospel of Jesus and the love for our neighbor hasn't changed. The world around us has. You know, in the last couple of years, we have new innovative ideas, new ways to share the gospel that has been active, you know, forever. And in the last few years, especially through COVID, we saw a very huge decrement around the world in all churches, in all denominations, people, you know, going to church. He has decreased. But the statement of Paul affirming that we are not lacking and that we have everything we need to be the church that God wants us to be gives me hope. That we are not lacking. That no matter in the world, people are not coming into church. We are not lacking. God will continue to equip us to be the church that God wants us to be. And we are about to embark another time of transition here at Spring Valley. Our beloved pastor, Paul, has announced his retirement on Friday. After more than 40 years of service as ordained minister. And Pastor Paul shares that he looks forward of being with Julie, his wife, his children, their grandchildren, and his father to share more fully in the joys and cares of life as a family. And today, as Apostle Paul will say, we give thanks to our God always. We give thanks for the life and ministry we share together with Pastor Paul, right? We give thanks because of all the things we have accomplished, continuing to fulfilling the mission to make disciples for the transformation of the world. And as we go into this new pastoral transition, I want to remind you, Church, Spring Valley, that we are not lacking. We are not lacking. So during this transition, we are encouraged to continue the work, the hard work that we do every day to be the church that God wants us to be. With all that God has enriched us as believers with speech, with knowledge, with spiritual gifts. So at Spring Valley, we're not lacking. We're not lacking as a church. We're not lacking as individuals. Because God is faithful. And we will continue to, God will continue to strengthen us through his Son, Jesus Christ, who lives in our hearts, right? Who lives on in our hearts and is calling us every day to continue to be a part of God's kingdom. So forget of those ideas that we're not lacking or that we're not enough or what we have is not enough. We have everything that we need to be the church. We have everything that we need to reach out to those that are looking for God. We have everything that we need to light the journey to those who haven't met Jesus. Because Jesus lives in our hearts, right? Jesus lives in us. And we're not lacking. God uses us. God has equipped us. God has already poured out in you, and you, and you, and you, and you, and me, everything that we need to continue God's mission, to continue to share the gospel, to continue to share the good news that Jesus Christ is here with us, that Jesus God is with us and works through us. Amen? So let us pray. God, we're thankful. We're thankful for the ways that you continue to call your church. We're thankful for the ways that you continue to surprise us, reminding us that we have everything, that we're not lacking of anything to be the church that you want us to be. Because God, the church, it's its people. It's not a building. Is the people coming together to work with you. The church is the people coming together to be used by you. Is the people coming together to help those in need, to help fight for justice, to hear the cry of the needy, to support one another in our own struggles in life. We are your church and we are not lacking. So God, we ask this morning that if we have those thoughts in our minds of wanting more and wishing more for your church, we want you to ensure us that what we really want is to share our joy to be with you, to share our joy to be part of your kingdom. Because being part of your kingdom is not something that's in the future, it's something that is right now at this very moment through your Son, Jesus Christ. So remind us, God, continue to lead us through your Holy Spirit to be the church that you want us to be, to help those that you sent to our way, to be open to receive help from others as well, to work together as the body of Christ, with Jesus Christ as our head. Struggles comes, difficult times comes, transitions comes in our lives, in our church, in our community, in the world. And we're not exempt to not experience those. It's part of life. But what we know is that you are with us. What we know is that you will continue to equip us. What we know is that since the moment we say yes to Jesus, you have poured out your heart in our lives. You have poured out your grace, the guidance of your Holy Spirit, the spiritual gifts, the knowledge of your Son, Jesus Christ. You have poured out so many things, God, in our lives. And we just ask this time, God, to be open to be used by you. To say we are not lacking. To say that we don't have to wait for a specific person to look up to, because we have the example of Jesus Christ. We don't have to wait to say, oh, if I have this, I will be a better Christian. No. We can be Christians at this very moment. We can be the best Christian at this very moment, right now. We don't have to wait to anybody else. We don't have to wait for a specific thing, because God, you already equip us. We are not lacking. So the only thing we can do is just to be open to be used by you for your church, for the world. And as we finish this prayer, God, we lift up part of our family, part of this church, George and Pam, who are out sick with a very bad cold. We lift up in prayer my bright family as they figure out their future in regarding to their jobs and accommodating themselves with this new baby in their lives. We lift up in prayer John Travers' family of the passing of his mom. Give them peace at this time, God. We lift up my cousin Lenny and his wife Pamela with the baby, 26-week baby girl being born. Give them courage, give them strength as they see this baby girl with all the machines helping her to be alive. And there's so many other things, God, that are happening around us, but that you remind us that we are in this together, that you remind us that we are not alone, that you remind us that we're not lacking. And we can be the church that you want us to be. All of this we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. And before we leave this amazing space of worship, I want to remind you a few announcements for all of you. We have our scene of the Martin Luther King speech at the sanctuary after worship. So when we're done here, we can all go together to the sanctuary and hear the speech. And also, I believe Pastor Paul, we have a few words about his retirement to all of us too. So it will be a very special time to be together. We have a youth lockout on Saturday, January 28th. From 5:30 to 8:30, the registration cost is $30. So if you know any youth and they will love to have fun, they will go to a place. I don't know. Dave and Buster. So I know it will be fun. I hope I can get to go too. I love to be with the youth and enjoy our time together. So you're all invited to go. And also for youth and parents, We have a new Bible study that is happening on Sundays at 10, both of them together, which is awesome, parents and youth. So this is a great opportunity. And my last announcement is that there's opportunity for all of you to continue to grow in our faith every Sunday at 10 with coffee and Jesus. There's lots of coffee and lots of Jesus in this small group that we come together, and we have been learning about God's will in our lives. And today's specific topic was about being reminded that God is with us all the time and how God works through us to continue his mission here on earth. So next week, we will finish our book, God's Will, by Adam Hamilton. So I hope that you can come and come at 10 and then, you know, enjoy some wonderful conversation. This is not a typical Sunday school. This is a small group. So it's more questions and answering and having a lots of conversation and lots of coffee. So come by at 10 on Sundays. And as the time of offering comes, we are invited to support our church with our tithes and offerings as part of God's mission. We're invited to be part of God's kingdom in this way as well. Through the offering that you give, we are able to support the missions of this church. Especially this morning, people came together to go to Austin Street to provide food for the homeless. So there are many ways that this church is active in our community, and you can be part of that as part of the offering. So let us pray together for our offering, and we can collect the offering as you go from this space. At the end of worship, in the middle aisle, there's a little basket that you can leave your offering there. But let us pray together. God, we give you thanks for the ways that you continue to support us, the many ways that you continue to support us in our works, in having a plate, a home to eat, having our, you know, anything that we need, a house, a shelter, and the many ways that you continue to support us. And at this time, we ask for a blessing for the many things that you give us, the little that we give back to you through our offerings. We ask you, God, to multiply them. We ask you, God, to use them wisely, to be very well administrative, that we can use them for your mission here at Spring Valley to be shared with our community. We ask for this blessing, and we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen. And let us continue to worship in our Lord.
I can just talk real loud.
Another good day. There it is. Okay. Thank you so much. Appreciate that. We're so glad once again each of y'all have decided and come to church with us today. We enjoy seeing some new faces and some repeat faces. Want to tell you to please invite people to come with you. We're having a wonderful time and an incredible experience here at Spring Valley, especially here in Common Ground. And I see this congregation just continue to grow and to grow and to grow. So we've been doing a theme throughout the song service this morning, talking about the light of the world, which is our season for this time. So if you would stand to your feet, we're going to talk about shine. We're going to sing about shine, Jesus, shine.
Love is shining in the midst of the darkness, shining. Jesus, light of the world, shine upon us. Set us free by the truth you now bring us. Shine on me. Shine on me.
Sing shine.
Shine, Jesus, shine. Land with the Father's glory. nations with grace and mercy. Send forth your word, Lord, and let there be light. Lord, I come to your awesome presence from the shadows into your radiance. By the blood I may enter your brightness. Search me, try me, consume all my darkness. Shine on me, shine on me, shine, Jesus, shine. Fill this land with the Father's glory.
Shining all week long.
Amen, amen, amen. So let us go from this place secure in the knowledge that we are not lacking in any spiritual gifts. We go into the world surrounded by the blessing of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the equipment of the Spirit to live and work as disciples who make disciples for the transformation of the world. Amen, and see you next Sunday. God bless you all.
Amen.